Yo, what's up guys? It's Noah here, and in today's video, we're going to be breaking down the NBA slate on DraftKings and Yahoo for Monday, May the 10th. We got a six-game Monday slate, as always guys. We're going to go game by game, go through each team and talk, you know, or go through each game and talk about each team on the six-game slate. I will give you guys my early thoughts, just, you know, what stands out to me looking at the slate the night before on Sunday night. So before we do get started with the breakdown, as always guys, I would appreciate it if you would click that like button down below. If you are new to the channel here, be sure to click that subscribe button as well. Also hit the notification bell so that way you do get notified every time I upload, and you also do get notified every time I live stream. I will be back with a live stream Monday afternoon. I didn't stream over the weekend. Normally I don't stream on the weekends, but I will be back with a stream Monday afternoon, probably around 5 Eastern time. Lock is 30 minutes later than normal, so I'll stream, you know, probably 30 minutes later than I normally do. Be live around 5 Eastern if you guys do want to come and hang out. I'll be live answering all your questions, talking through the slate once again with you guys in the live stream. So be sure to tune into that. Also, you know, if you do really enjoy these YouTube videos, you do enjoy the content I put out on YouTube, I have additional stuff available on Patreon. If you do want to check that out, it's linked down below in the description. I give full updated core plays on Patreon. I have a Discord chat that's available for Patreon members where you can basically ask me questions up until lock, even after lock. I'm in the Discord and I'm around to answer questions. So if that's something that interests you, you want to see more content, more that I have to offer, you can check out the Patreon link down below in the description. But yeah, guys, let's go ahead and take a look at Monday's slate. We'll start off with the Wizards and Hawks game. So I would say this is probably the most appealing game on the slate, especially on the Wizards side. We already know that Bradley Beal is going to be out for Washington today, which is obviously huge news. With Bradley Beal out, you guys know the biggest beneficiary, it's going to be Russell Westbrook, and I have no idea why, but for some reason, DraftKings has yet to raise Russell Westbrook's price. He has scored, let's see, he has scored at least 63 DK points in 8 of his last 10 games. You've gotten at least 63 DK points from Westbrook. He has multiple games over 80, he's got multiple games over 70, and for some reason, he is still only 11K on DraftKings. Bradley Beal is also out today, and Westbrook is still only 11K. I really don't know what DraftKings is doing here. I mean, Westbrook's been basically a lock like for 2 weeks straight now, and now that Bradley Beal's out, like, it's hard just to not just click Westbrook in. I mean, if he was like 12K today, then maybe it would be a little bit of a different story, but 11K, I mean, you just almost have to play Westbrook. I know he's going to be like 70-80% owned, but there just really feels like there's no way he fails here. I hate that I say that, because now that I say that, something's going to go wrong, but if Westbrook plays his full minutes and this game stays close, I mean, he is very likely to score probably 65-70 DraftKings points at the minimum. He's very likely to triple-double here. He's already been a fantasy monster this season, and now that you take Bradley Beal off the floor, there's just going to be even more opportunity for Russell Westbrook. He's a lock today, clearly the best play on the slate. I don't need to tell you that. Even on Yahoo, where they price him up a little bit, I still think he's a great pay-up option over there. Obviously love Russell Westbrook today with Bradley Beal out. But with Beal out, there's also some other beneficiaries. Rui Hachimura is someone that I do like a lot here with Bradley Beal out. Now, I really don't play Rui Hachimura. I haven't played him much at all this season. But when I have played Rui, it was, you know, during that stretch when Beal was out. Beal sat out for, I believe, like a week or two. And we did see Rui play really well for that stretch of games when Beal was not playing. His price got up to like 6K, close to 7K. He definitely gets more usage and more opportunity when you do take Bradley Beal off the floor. For 4,900, like, that is way too cheap for Rui here. We should get big minutes from him. He should play probably 36, 38 minutes here if this game stays close. He's a guy that, you know, can be a pretty good offensive player. He's going to probably be second on the team in scoring behind Russell Westbrook. He's going to be the second guy they look to in offense behind Westbrook. So I do like Rui quite a bit as well. I think playing him and Westbrook makes a ton of sense. On Yahoo, I do like Rui over there as well at $19. Him and Westbrook are my two favorite plays from the Wizards. There's other guys you could go to as well, like Raul Neto, I think, benefits without Bradley Beal. You know, at 4,500, he kind of feels priced appropriately. It's not like he's that cheap, but still a viable option. Should play a few more minutes. Should be more productive now that Beal is not out there. So I don't mind Neto either. I think Davis Bertans coming off the bench benefits 3,700. If you want to go to him as a value option, I could definitely see doing that. Now, you never know what you're going to get from Bertans, but you would think with no Beal out there, there's going to be more usage available for him, just more shot attempts to go around. Bertans probably plays around 30 minutes off the bench, so at 3,700, he's another value play worth considering. And then, you know, a guy like Ish Smith in tournaments as a low-owned option you could maybe go to. Obviously, I feel better about Raul Neto, but I think we probably get like 23, 24 minutes from Ish Smith. He's really cheap, 3,300. he's a fine, you know, low-owned tournament play, but really, I think the guys that stand out the most from Washington are definitely Westbrook and Rui, two guys I like most, and then Rod Neto, Davis Bertans, I think, are decent plays as well, but Westbrook and Rui are the really the core plays here from the Wizards for me. Now, on the Atlanta side, I do have some interest in some of these Hawks today. I don't know if there's any, like, core plays coming from Atlanta for me. I think these are more tournament options, but these guys definitely have upside. It is a good matchup against the Wizards. This should be, you know, a pretty high scoring game. I don't think we have a total yet here, but I would assume we do get a pretty high total in this game. Trae Young at 9,300, I think looks like a pretty good pay up option if you want to play him with Russell Westbrook. I think that makes plenty of sense. Obviously, Westbrook is going to be the stud that I prioritize today, but if I can find a way to get Westbrook and Trae Young together, you know, if a lot of value opens up as the day goes on, that is definitely something I'm going to be looking to do. This is a really good matchup for Trae Young, pace up spot here against a Wizards team that we know plays fast. They're not the best defensive team. 9,300, pretty nice price tag for Trae Young in a good matchup like this. So I do have interest in him. Clint Capella, it's a good matchup for Capella, but like his minutes have just been so up in the air lately. His production's kind of been down as well. I think you're just kind of like, I don't know, you're just kind of buying low on Capella at this point. We know the upside that he has. We know he's someone that can put up, you know, 50-plus DK points any night. But, man, he's just not been playing well lately. He's got 8 straight games with less than 40 fantasy points. Not saying that's going to continue, but Capella is pretty tough to trust right now until we actually see him have a good game. If you want to go there in tournaments, I think it's okay. But really, I think Trae Young is the guy I like most from Atlanta. Capella, you know, John Collins, I think these are just low on tournament options. Guys you could play just because, you know, they have upside in a good matchup like this, but they're not guys I'm very confident in. Like, John Collins has been so up and down this season. Could he give you a good game here in a good matchup? He absolutely could, but am I confident that happens? No. Trae Young's the guy I really like from Atlanta. So that does it for this game. Moving on to the next one, we got the Pacers and the Cavs. Now, on the Pacers side today, we'll need to keep an eye on the status of Malcolm Brogdon. He is currently questionable. He's been out for, I believe, a few games now. He's been out for at least like a week or two. If Brogdon does remain out, I mean, we know who benefits. Domantas Sabonis, Caris LeVert, TJ McConnell off the bench. Those are the guys that are going to benefit if Brogdon sits. You know, at their price points in a relatively, you know, slow-paced game and a pace-down spot against Cleveland, I don't think Sabonis, LeVert, or McConnell would be priorities for me today. Obviously, I'm going to prefer Westbrook over Galaxy Sabonis, but Sabonis is another guy that's just been playing so well lately, been stuffing the stat sheet. He's got at least 70 DraftKings points in 3 of his last 5 games. Clearly, without Miles Turner, and if there is no Brogdon, like, Sabonis is going to dominate the usage on this team. You can go to him at 10,600. I think he's another good pay-up option. I'm still going to play Westbrook over him, but, you know, if you want to play Sabonis, I think he's a good play. I think if Brogdon does wind up playing, that would definitely be a bump down for Sabonis, but Sabonis would at least still be viable. Caris LeVert at 9K, if Brogdon's in, no interest in LeVert for me. If Brogdon is out, though, I think LeVert's a pretty good option as well. And then TJ McConnell, if Brogdon's out, you could look to at 5,700 as a, you know, tournament option. But I don't think I'm going to any of the other guys from Indiana. It's really just the big three, Sabonis, LeVert, McConnell, if Brogdon's out. If Brogdon plays, then it's really just Sabonis, and that's probably it from Indiana. Now, on the Cleveland side, there isn't really much I like on Cleveland. Darius Garland did not play on Sunday. We'll have to see if he plays here on the back-to-back. Even if he does, or even if he is out again, I don't think that really impacts too much. Like, Colin Sexton's been priced up to a point where I don't really want to go to him at 8,300. Jetty Osmond was out on Sunday, so maybe if he's out as well, we could look to a guy like Dean Wade for value. Dean Wade did start on Sunday with Jetty Osmond out. He played 30 minutes, but he was not productive at all. He only had 15 DraftKings points. Could you go to Dean Wade as a value option? I guess you could, but there's really no standout plays from Cleveland. This Cleveland team is a team that I've kind of just been avoiding for like a week straight now, and I just don't think I'm going to roster any Cavs on this slate. Unless we get word that some guys are resting like on the back-to-back, I just don't think I'm going to play any Cavs today. So moving on to the next game, we got New Orleans and Memphis. New Orleans, they're going to be another team to keep an eye on when it comes to injuries. We do already know that Zion's going to be out. I mean, he's pretty much out for the season. But Brandon Ingram is, you know, a reported injury to watch. He did not play Sunday. He was doubtful for Sunday's game. I'm assuming that Brandon Ingram is going to remain out here. But you do keep an eye on this. Josh Hart has a chance to return. I don't know if he's going to be ready to return for this game, but he might play before the season ends. We'll have to wait and see. If Josh Hart returns, I assume he'll be on a, you know, pretty big minute or pretty strict minutes limit, given he hasn't played in so long. And then Steven Adams, he was questionable on Sunday. He did not play. We'll have to keep an eye on that as well. So really, Brandon Ingram is the big one. Ingram was doubtful. I'm assuming that he'll probably sit out this game as well. I mean, I'd be surprised if he plays this, you know, the rest of the season, just because the Pelicans, I mean, their playoff chances have pretty much diminished. I mean, they don't, I don't think they're going to make the playoffs or even get into the play-in tournament. So it really feels like no reason for them to rush Brandon Ingram back if he's not fully healthy. So with Zion out, with Brandon Ingram most likely out again, you know, we can look to guys like Lonzo Ball, Eric Bledsoe. Now, Lonzo, God, he's killed me the last two slates. I played him again on Sunday night slate, and he had another pretty bad game, which is super tilting. Friday night, when Ingram and Zion were both out, Lonzo did not have a good game against the Sixers. Only 34 DK points in 34 minutes. And then in Sunday night's game, he didn't have that great of a game either against Charlotte. Only finished with 22 fantasy points in 30 minutes. Like, Lonzo has not been playing that well lately. He's burned me two slates in a row. I think you can go back to him just because he is going to be low-owned. I mean, two straight stinkers. Like, nobody's going to play Lonzo today. But I still think the upside is there. You know, without Brandon Ingram, without Zion, there's plenty of opportunity for Lonzo. It's just, he's tough to click right now. I mean, two straight, you know, bad games. I know, you know, you got to have a short memory when you play DFS, but I don't think I'm going to play Lonzo today. If I don't play Lonzo, that means he's probably going to smash. I already know it. You know, I played him Friday. He sucked. I played him Sunday. He sucked. If I don't play him today, he's going to smash. And if I do play him, he's going to suck again. I don't think I'm going to go to Lonzo, though. I think Eric Bledsoe is actually the guy I like most from the Pelicans. He's actually been playing the best between the two guards. He's been playing really well these last two games without Ingram and without Zion. He had another big game on Sunday night. Played 33 minutes against Charlotte. Had 50 fantasy points, 24 points, 4 rebounds, 11 assists, 2 steals from Eric Bledsoe. Like, I said it in my video Sunday, like, Bledsoe, he hasn't been that productive with the Pelicans this year on a, you know, point-per-minute basis, but this is a guy that can be productive when he does get the opportunity, and obviously without no Zion and without Ingram, there's more opportunity available for Eric Bledsoe. He's going to get more usage, going to have the ball in his hands more, just going to be able to take more shots, and we've seen him play really well these last two games. I think that continues today. I do like Eric Bledsoe once again. I think he's way too cheap on Yahoo at $17, and even with the price coming up to $5,900 on DK, I still do like Eric Bledsoe quite a bit on DK as well, assuming that, you know, Brandon Ingram does remain out here. And then we can look to some of the other guys as well, like Willie Hernangómez. He didn't play a ton of minutes on Sunday. He only played around 21 minutes, I believe. But he did have a really good game. He was very productive. Played 22 minutes, had 34 fantasy points, 9 points, 16 rebounds, 1 assist, 2 steals and a block, or 2 steals and a block. Like, if Steven Adams sits again, I think Hernangómez is a fine option to go to. Jackson Hayes had another massive game off the bench. He played 26 minutes, had 48 fantasy points. He's been insanely productive these last two games. Against Philly, 23 minutes, 44 fantasy points. Against Charlotte on Sunday night, 26 minutes, 48 fantasy points. You know, I don't really know if I want to chase these Jackson Hayes games. He was pretty low-owned again on Sunday. I don't know what his ownership's going to look like today. But obviously, without Ingram, without Zion, you know, Jackson Hayes does benefit. He's been way more productive lately than he normally is. If you want to go to Jackson Hayes, I think he's an okay option. I don't think I'm going to go there. I think I'll let other people chase that, but clearly he's been playing well. The minutes have been up for him. He could be an option to go to if Steven Adams sits. Najee Marshall at 5K, I think, you know, okay play. James Johnson, though, I do like for value still. 4,600 on DK. He's still relatively cheap. You know, the price tag is coming up a little bit, but without Zion and without Ingram, James Johnson should be looking at around 30 minutes a night, you know, moving forward till these guys return, if they even do return. Johnson did play 30 and a half minutes on Sunday night against Charlotte, and he was productive, had 33 fantasy points, 17 points, 8 rebounds, and 3 steals. Like, James Johnson has always been, you know, around a fantasy point per minute player. If he's going to play around 30 minutes, I think he's a really good value. Once again, he's minimum salary on Yahoo. I like him a lot there. And on DraftKings, even at 4,600, I still think James Johnson looks like a really good option on DK. So a lot to like from this Pelicans team for sure, especially if Brandon Ingram remains out, if Steven Adams remains out. We can look to guys like Lonzo, Eric Bledsoe, James Johnson, Hernangómez, maybe Jackson Hayes, even though I don't think I'm going to go there. You can maybe play him. You can maybe play Najee Marshall. But I would say my favorite Pelicans today are definitely Eric Bledsoe, James Johnson, and Lonzo Ball, you know, assuming that Ingram does not play. If Ingram plays, and obviously that'll change some things, I'll probably be off of James Johnson. But for now, I'm assuming that Ingram does remain out here. But on the other side of this game, looking at the Memphis side, you know, it is a good matchup here for these Grizzlies. I don't know if any of these Grizzlies are going to be guys I look to, like, in cash games. I think they're more just, like, low-owned tournament options. I don't see, like, a ton of chalk coming from this Memphis team. I expect, you know, basically everyone on Memphis to be relatively low-owned. John Morant, if you want to go there in tournaments, I think he's an okay option. John Morant's been someone that's killed me basically every time I play him, but in a good matchup, I think he's viable. Now, I would probably rather play Lonzo over John Morant. I know Lonzo's been terrible as well, but I think Lonzo is someone I'd rather play for lower ownership over Ja if Lonzo is lower owned. Even if he's not, I think I'd still rather play Lonzo. Joe Val, you know, you can go there at center. 8,200, it's kind of expensive, but we know the kind of upside that Joe Val has. Going to play probably 32, 34 minutes here if this game stays close. We know Joe Val is a super productive player when he's on the floor. He's a good tournament option. I think he should be low owned. I do want to mention Jaren Jackson Jr. He did move into the starting lineup last game. He played 26 minutes, had 36 DK points. I'm assuming that he's going to start moving forward. So if Jaren Jackson Jr. is going to stick in the starting lineup, we probably get around 25 to 30 minutes from him on a nightly basis. Triple J is someone that can also be productive when he's on the floor. He will average around a fantasy point per minute. So honestly, he might be my favorite play from Memphis. I think if I had to go to any Grizzlies today, it probably would be Jaren Jackson Jr., assuming that he does start. Grayson Allen's out again. You know, you could go to Desmond Bane, but I don't think I can click on Desmond Bane, especially after he, you know, killed me that day against Detroit. He only played 21 minutes, only had 10 DK points. Like, Desmond Bane, just not a guy I really want to roster. The price is coming up. I don't think I'm going to go there. I think it's really Triple J. And then, you know, in tournaments, Ja Morant, Joe Val, I think make, you know, for good low-owned options. But that does it for Memphis. Moving on to the next game, we got Milwaukee and San Antonio. So on Milwaukee today, you have Giannis at the top for 10,800. You know, I think Giannis, as always, is a good pay-up option on this slate. I obviously prefer Russell Westbrook. Westbrook's the guy I like the most at the top. But if I can fit Westbrook and Giannis together, you know, maybe I'll try and do that. You know, we've talked about some other studs. We've talked about Trae Young. We talked about Sabonis. Those are guys I do like as well. But Giannis definitely up there. You know, any slate Giannis is on, I'm going to have interest in him. He's such a productive player when he's on the floor. We know Giannis has, you know, triple-double upside basically every night. Should get, you know, normal minutes here. Should play around 33, 34 minutes if this game does stay close. He only played 29 minutes last game, but I'd assume we get back to like 32, 34 minutes from Giannis if this game is close. So at 10,800, I think he's a, you know, good pay-up option. But outside of Giannis, I'm not considering any other Bucks today. It's Giannis or nothing for me from this Milwaukee team. Now on the San Antonio side, this is not a team I really have much interest in. You know, DeMar DeRozan, Deontay Murray, I think are good tournament options. They should be pretty low-owned. We know they always have upside, but neither one are priorities for me. I don't think I'd be playing either one of those two guys like in my main lineup. But good tournament plays. If you're making a lot of lineups, I'd have them in my player pool. But overall, this San Antonio team has kind of been a team I've been avoiding lately. And, you know, I think it's going to continue here. There's just not much that really stands out from the Spurs outside of the top two guys, Murray and DeRozan. You know, you could go to in tournaments. But next game, we got Utah and Golden State. Now, on the Utah side, we do know that Donovan Mitchell and Rudy Gobert are both going to be, or not Rudy Gobert, but Donovan Mitchell and Mike Conley are both going to be out again. So with no Mitchell, no Conley, you know, at this point we know who benefits. Jordan Clarkson, Bojan, Ingles have all been the biggest beneficiaries without, you know, Mitchell and Conley. But they've all been priced up to a point where really none of them are standout plays for me. Clarkson's almost 8K. Like, I just don't think I need to pay nearly 8K for Jordan Clarkson. Joe Ingles is 6,300. Bojan's 6,600. I don't feel like I need to pay 6,600 for a scoring dependent player like Bojan. Joe Ingles would probably be the one Utah guy I would consider just because, you know, with him starting at point guard, there's more assist opportunities for him. You know, he's going to have the ball in his hands more. The upside's a little bit higher for Ingles. But I don't really like any of these Utah guys. I haven't really been playing them lately. I don't think I'm going to play any of them today. They just don't feel, you know, like, I don't really feel like I need to go there given where they're priced at. You know, if you play Yahoo, then maybe you could look to some of these guys like Bojan for 24. I don't mind. Ingles for 22 you could go to. Clarkson is 25. So, you know, maybe you could play them on Yahoo. But overall, this Utah team is just not a team I really have much interest in today. Now, on the Golden State side, there isn't much I like on Golden State. You know, Curry's been playing amazing lately. It's hard to argue with, you know, how well he's played. He's just been scoring at will. Just been putting up massive game after massive game. Curry's always a guy that I'm pretty, you know, underweight on. Normally, I never pay up for Curry. There's always going to be studs I prefer over him. That's probably going to be the case once again today. Like, I think I'd rather play Westbrook, or I would definitely rather play Westbrook. I think I'd rather play Giannis and Sabonis over Curry. I think I'd rather take the savings and play a guy like Trae Young. So I don't think I'm going to get to Steph Curry today. You know, in a big-time game like this against the Jazz, we should get full minutes from Curry. The matchup's not great, but we know the kind of upside that Steph has when he plays his normal 36, 38 minutes. I mean, even in three quarters last game against OKC, he put up 65 DK points in only 29 minutes. Like, Curry's just been awesome. It's hard to argue with what he's been doing. He's just, in terms of DFS, with how scoring dependent he is, Normally, there's other studs I prefer over him, like Westbrook. We know Westbrook is going to go out there and most likely triple-double. Westbrook doesn't need to score 40 points to really get there. He can do it with the peripherals. Whereas Curry, if he has a bad shooting game, I mean, you can get like a really bad game from Curry. Like, we've seen his floor. His floor is a lot lower than other studs, I will say. So I don't think I'm going to get to Curry today. He's always viable, but for me, there's other studs I prefer. Draymond is 7,600. You could look to. I don't think I'm going to play Draymond on this slate, but we know Draymond always has triple-double upside, can go out there and put up 45, 50 DK points any night. He had a really good game in limited minutes against OKC, only played three quarters, but still had 46 DK points. So Draymond, Curry, I think are the two Warriors I'd be looking to today, but no interest in Wiggins, no interest in Bazemore, no interest in, you know, Toscano-Anderson. It's really just the top two guys, Curry and Green for me. That's probably it. But last game of the night, we got Houston and Portland. Houston, going to be a team to keep an eye on. So this Houston team, basically for like the last week or so, has just been incredibly shorthanded every single night. We know Sterling Brown, Avery Bradley, DJ Wilson, John Wall, Dante Exum, David Nwaba are all going to be out. You know, I'm pretty sure all those guys are probably going to be out the rest of the season. I'd be surprised if any of them return. Maybe DJ Wilson returns, but probably likely that you see those guys just, you know, sit out the rest of the season. We do know that Kevin Porter Jr. is out again. Eric Gordon remains out. The big news, though, is that Christian Wood and Kelly Olynyk are both questionable. They were both out last game, so this will be something to monitor. If they both play, that does kind of lower my interest in basically a lot of these Houston guys. If Wood and Olynyk both play, I don't think I'm going to go to either one on this slate at their prices. Neither one would stand out as top options for me. If they do play, that does give Houston 10 bodies. So, you know, Houston, they will have enough bodies to where they can spread out the minutes enough to where I don't know if there'd be any standout plays from Houston outside of the backcourt. I think the backcourt is where we can look to some value from this Houston team. They do remain pretty shorthanded in with the guards, you know, when it comes to their guards. They have DJ Augustine, they have Daquan Jeffries, and they have, you know, Brooks and Thomas off the bench, but really those are their only healthy guards. And we've seen Thomas Brooks and Jeffries, you know, play big minutes these last few games. I think that continues here. 37 minutes from Jeffrey's last game, 32 the game before that, 41. So he's played at least 32 minutes in three straight games. Armani Brooks off the bench has played at least 30 minutes in three straight games. And then Kyrie Thomas, he's played two games with Houston. They recently signed him. He's played 23 and 34 minutes in the two games that he's been with Houston. DJ Augustine, I think, is someone that's going to probably get limited from this, you know, I would say that his minutes are going to be limited, you know, when it comes to this Houston team. Like, he's an older guy. They really have no reason to push him. That's why you're seeing more minutes for Armani Brooks, more minutes for Kyrie Thomas, more minutes for Daquan Jeffries. Like, I just don't think Augustine's going to be a guy that goes out there and plays 36 minutes a night. I expect them to probably limit him to, like, mid-20s minutes, most likely. He only played 18 on Saturday against Utah, but I think a lot of that had to do with it being a back-to-back. He'll probably get back to, like, 25 minutes a day, but I don't think you get massive minutes from DJ Augustine, which kind of makes him tough to roster. I think the other guys are going to be the ones I look to from this Houston team. Kyrie Thomas, honestly, might be my favorite play from Houston. He's been really good through two games with the Rockets. Like I said, he recently signed a 10-day contract with them. He's played two games. First game against Milwaukee, he played 23 minutes off the bench, had 30 DK points. Then last game against Utah, he looked amazing, played 34 minutes, had 52 DK points. He took 21 shots, had 27 points, 5 rebounds, 3 assists, two blocks, and 5 steals. Like, he's been super productive. He's been over a fantasy point per minute player with the Rockets so far. I know it's a small sample size, but with how, you know, injury depleted this team is right now, I think the opportunity is going to be there for Kyrie Thomas. I expect him to play around 25 to 30 minutes a night moving forward, basically till the end of the regular season. At 5,500, I think he is still a little bit underpriced. I don't know what his ownership is going to look like today, but I definitely do like Kyrie Thomas here. And I like him a lot on Yahoo. If you play over on Yahoo, he is minimum salary over there. He is clearly a top value play on Yahoo. There's no reason for him to be minimum salary. He's a guy that I'm going to be jamming in on Yahoo for sure. And then you can look to like Armani Brooks. He's been a lot better lately. He was a guy that we've rostered at points this season, and you know, he hasn't really been that productive before, but he's been a lot better lately in terms of production. 31 minutes, 28 DK points, 34 minutes, 40 DK points, 33 minutes, 27 DK points. Been averaging close to a fantasy point per minute. Probably plays around 30 minutes here. One thing I do like is, you know, Brooks, Thomas, even if Houston gets blown out here, which is, you know, likely, this Houston team is just terrible. They're going to get blown out a lot. You're going to see Brooks out there in a blowout. You're going to see Thomas out there in a blowout. Augustine would be someone that would definitely, you know, lose minutes if it's a blowout. So that makes me feel good about guys like Brooks and Thomas. You know, even if the game gets super ugly and if they're down by like 40, I mean, those guys are still going to be out there chucking up shots. So I do like both of them. I think Jeffries is viable as well. We do need to talk about KJ Martin and Jayshon Tate, though. I think if one of Christian Wood or Kelly Olynyk plays, you know, if they both play, I'm not going to Jayshon Tate. I'm not going to KJ Martin if they both play. If one of them play, though, and one of them is out, then I would definitely look to Tate and Martin. Tate, last game, played 29 minutes. He was super productive, had 41 DK points. His first game back, I thought he was going to be limited somewhat, but he did play 29 minutes, and he nearly triple-doubled. He was two rebounds shy of a triple-double. You know, obviously, with all these guys out for Houston right now, the opportunity is there for Jayshon Tate. He should be productive when he's on the floor, especially if, you know, Wood and Olynyk do not play. And KJ Martin, I mean, we've seen what he's been doing lately. Been playing massive minutes, been super productive. Last three games, 50, 47, and 50 DK points. He's played 44, 39, and 39 minutes. Like, he's playing nearly 40 minutes a night right now. I would say that if Christian Wood and Kelly Olynyk both play, that does make me a bit worried about KJ Martin, just because I don't think he's going to play as many minutes with Tate back, or with Wood back, with Olynyk back, if they were to return. That would definitely cut into the minutes for KJ Martin. He would most likely move back to the bench, I would assume. We'd probably still get around 25 to 30 minutes, but I don't know if he would be worth the $6,200 salary. But if one of those two guys are out, if Wood is out, or if Olynyk's out, and KJ Martin starts again, I think he's a pretty good play at $6,200, because it's clear they're just going to run him into the ground. They're running out of bodies right now. KJ Martin's a young guy. They're going to play him big minutes moving forward. For $6,200, you're going to need a big game from him, but clearly the upside is there for him. He's been super productive. So yeah, there's a lot to like from this Rockets team just with how shorthanded they are right now. There's so many minutes to go around. If Wood and Olynyk play, that will cut my interest in some of these Houston guys, but if Wood and Olynyk are both out, I mean, KJ Martin, Jayshon Tate, Armani Brooks, Kyrie Thomas, Daquan Jeffries, like, these are going to be guys I look to for sure. A lot to like from Houston on this slate. But that probably does it for this game. Like, on the Portland side, I don't really see much I like on Portland. A lot of my interest is coming from the Houston side, you know, with all these guys we've talked about. You know, Dame in tournaments you could maybe go to, but I would rather play Trae Young, I think, in a better matchup. That game's also more likely to stay close. I don't think I'm going to be paying up for Dame today. Yusuf Nurkic you could go to maybe at $7,300. You know, especially if Christian Wood and Kelly Olynyk are both out, I mean, it becomes a really good matchup for Yusuf Nurkic. Like, KJ Martin's going to be super undersized, and it's going to, you know, going to have a tough time defending Nurkic. But I think Nurkic is just like a tournament play at best. I don't think he's going to be someone I really consider in cash games or for my main lineup. I don't know if there's any standout plays from Houston or from Portland, but guys like Nurkic, Dame, you know, you could go to in tournaments for the low ownership that, you know, I most likely, or I would expect, you know, basically everyone on Portland's going to be low owned today on DK. But that probably does it for this game, guys. I think we broke down everything, talked through everything on the 6-game slate. So I hope you guys did enjoy the video. I do appreciate you watching. If you did enjoy, click that like button down below before you do get out of here, and also be sure to hit that subscribe button as well. Click the notification bell too, so that way you do get notified every time I upload, and you also do get notified every time I live stream. I will be back with a live stream on Monday afternoon. I'll be live around 5 Eastern, so if you guys want to tune into my YouTube channel then, I should be live breaking down the slate, talking through everything with you guys, answering all your questions as always. But yeah, best of luck on the slate, guys. Thanks for watching the video. Hope you did enjoy. We'll see you in the next one.